welcome to another edition of All About Berea. I'm Chad Hembry.
And I'm Beth Myers.
And joining us in the studio is Mr. Jonathan Schenhofen. Thanks for being back. Did you have a good trip?
Well, I was very ill, so, you know, I'm glad to be back.
And it's a combination of a trip and then the next time was the illness, so yeah.
I had a trip.
Safe? No.
Oh,
I
yeah.
don't know.
Yeah, I did have a good trip.
I was going to say, you did have a trip.
It's
I did
when
not,
we actually...
I'm not tripping. You had
no,
a trip.
No, I had a trip. I had a good trip, and then I had a really bad illness. So you know, now I'm tripped out, and I'm sicked out, so, you know, we're all good now.
So, hey,
thanks
let's
for
go.
Having me.
All right. Well, we've got quite a bit to talk about. We've got a guest coming in later, I believe.
Yeah, Greg Powell's going to come in and talk about the Spoonbread Festival.
Fantastic. Well, we look forward to having him here. And Spoonbread, of course, being the largest event in Berea. So,
but a bum.
Yeah.
17th, right?
That's right.
And they said it wouldn't last.
Yeah, that's right. It was, and I was very fortunate to be on the... original group, you know, that put that together. I was actually chair of the parade.
I remember the first Spoonbread Festival, and may I say it's improved every year.
And the date for that, it will be the 20th, 21st, and 22nd of September.
That's right.
Yeah. All right. So anyway, we'll talk about that later when he's here. Without further ado, let's go ahead and get started with the show and start with four things you should know.
Thanks, Chad. In four things you should know. Number one, the Madison County School Board public hearing this past Monday to vote on the property tax rate for the upcoming year was a tense evening for both participants and school board members. The two main groups that mostly testified at the 2.5-hour hearing were school personnel and community members concerned about tax increases. The school board had put forth a proposal to raise the property tax rate from 58.3 on real property and 58.8 on personal property to 60 cents on both real and personal property. It did end up getting approved. New Superintendent Elmer Thomas stated that the increase would be used to establish all-day kindergarten in Madison County. During the hearing, people became pretty emotional. One teacher said she felt that the community members' resistance to the tax rate increase was a slap in the face. Community members are equally passionate, stating to the school board members that we don't believe anything you say, we don't trust you, and you'll just waste our money again. Board member John Lackey, who's been a voice for fiscal conservatism on the board and often voted in the minority, stated that it was tremendously good strategy to say you will use the extra money for full-day kindergarten. He agreed that the public couldn't trust the board and accused them of funding a resume for former Superintendent Tommy Floyd, who took a job at the Kentucky Department of Education after the 2012-13 school year. He commented that he would trust Thomas for 1 year and would support the tax rate increase to see if he would make the needed spending cuts. Becky Coyle made a motion to raise the personal and real property tax rates to 60 cents, and Beth Brock seconded it. All voted for it except Mary Renfro. Secondly, the Madison County Library is going to be celebrating their 25th anniversary this year, with the anniversary opening gala taking place at their location in Richmond this Sunday from 2 to 4 p.m. The library in Berea will also be celebrating all weekend with an ice cream social from 3 to 5 p.m. on Friday, followed by cupcakes, pony rides, and balloon animals on Sunday from 10 to 12. In celebration of this landmark anniversary, the library will be offering a special focus or program once a month. Two spaces will be dedicated on Sunday, honoring the first library director, Sue Hayes, who's passed away, and Dr. Stuart Tobin. It'll be the Sue Hayes Library Annex in the Dr. Stuart Tobin Technology Commons. Hayes was a tireless advocate for the Madison County Public Library as the first director. She can be credited for much of its eventual success. Tobin led the campaign and petition drive for the fiscal court to establish the public library district. And I want to make a correction. When I talked about the cupcakes, pony rides, and balloon animals, that's going to be Saturday, not Sunday. And three something news coming up. The Madison County Fairgrounds is going to be host to a new church next month, one with a casual come-as-you-are attitude and a focus on ministry with a country twist. This is the Rugged Cross Cowboy Church. It'll have its first service on Thursday, October 10 at the Fairgrounds at 7 p.m. Services are going to be occurring every Thursday evening at the same time and same place in the arena outside, weather permitting. Jeff Duncan's going to be the pastor. He'll be traveling up from Paris. Cowboy churches started as a way to reach people who live a rancher's or farmer's life, since they can't take off Sunday mornings or take the time to clean up for a service. The cowboy churches invite them to worship in outside places, such as the fairgrounds, with like-minded people. Music is usually bluegrass, country gospel. As an introduction to the Rugged Cross Cowboy Church, there will be a horse whisper at the Madison County Fairgrounds on September 19th at 7 p.m. Paul Daly, who funded Wild Horse Ministries in Louisiana with his wife Joanna, will reportedly tame a wild horse, or rather an unridden horse, within 2 hours without using force of any kind. During this taming, Daly will relate everything he does to his ministry. The event is free and open to the public. And last, Silver Creek Elementary had a nasty shock last week when Ashley Durison, who's 30 years old, the elected treasurer of the Silver Creek PTO for the 2012-2000 academic year, was arrested and charged with theft by failure to make required disposition of property of $10,000 or more. According to Berea Police, this former treasurer personally took $12,157 from various fundraising events that the PTO had conducted. Durison was responsible for depositing these funds and paying any relevant bills, and then distributing those profits as the PTO officers directed. There were 5 different fundraiser events involved with the money. The Berea police were notified when the new PTO treasurer elected for this academic year noticed the missing funds and contacted them on August 22nd. The police then began investigating and issued a warrant for Durison's arrest on September 6th. She turned herself in the same day at the Madison County Detention Center. And that is it for 4 things you should know.
Well, I'm excited. I'll have a cupcake in one hand, a book in the other, and I'll be riding up and down the Dewey Decimal System on my horse.
We're going to tax you for that.
Yeah, I was looking at the paper this week. I'm like, it's all county. Lots of things happen in that neck of the woods.
Well, I bet this song got like a good time, though, to be at the county fair. I mean, at the county fair, at the county library. It sounds like it'll be neat.
And I should say, the opening gala, just in case people are going to get offended, the opening gala is in Richmond, partly in honor to the fact that the first building was in Richmond, but the closing one that they're going to do in May will be in Berea, like the big closing festival.
It doesn't offend me. It was open first. It's the largest one.
I mean, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to people who might otherwise, you know,
I'm
feel
offended.
Like Berea's not... See?
I think
See?
We have Adulter. A beautiful library, and I don't feel like we've been slighted.
I'm not saying people would be. I'm just saying in case. I should hasten to assure them that there's also going to be a party in Berea at the end. So.
Okay. Well, I'll take that. All right, let's talk about the other good thing before we get to the 2 bad ones, and that being the fairgrounds, the church.
The Rugged Church. I had never heard of cowboy churches before.
I hadn't either, but I think that it's the coolest thing I've heard all week.
When are they going to have a couch potato church?
Yeah.
You know,
it's called television in the morning.
I don't want to dress up.
There's no air conditioning.
Well, it was funny because I talked to Duncan on the phone, the one who's coming up from Paris, and he said only 35% in the cowboy churches actually have livestock. But these are like country people. And he said, you know, we'll hear about people who say, well, you know, churches don't want me, and so this is who they're trying to get. He's like, we're not trying to get people going to another church. We're trying to get the people who feel uncomfortable in church. The one in Paris actually started in the stockyards and then moved on to the fairgrounds in, Bourbon County.
I like bluegrass. I might go.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. They were working through Tate's Creek Baptist Association. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting. And I'm kind of tempted to go to this horse whisper. Evidently, after 2-3 hours, he then rides it, and then he gets it to lay down.
That's incredible. Well, and I have only seen it on TV, but if it's like it is on TV, then it's amazing.
This will actually be a horse from Madison County, the woman who's going to give it. And again, it's not like a horse who's out.
No, they didn't go get it off the island.
Didn't go get it. It's not a feral horse. It's a horse like somebody owns, but it's never been ridden, and it kind of roams free, or it's halter broke, but, you know, nobody's ridden it.
They didn't find it. Buried
yeah,
it
they didn't, coach, the they didn't go chase it down and rope it and bring it in.
Thaw it out. Now this historic pony's going to be broken. No.
but eventually, evidently, it really centers around the horse. They do a lot of trail rides, things like that. So they'll stay out in the outdoor arena, and then, of course, when it gets too cold, they'll go to the indoor arena at the fairgrounds. But it's not like they're looking to ever I mean, these aren't temporary locations. This is where they keep their churches.
I'm just hoping this doesn't give you any ideas to start looking for a husband whisperer.
She's going to break you.
Yeah.
Now, she enjoyed the hard way. So.
Yeah.
She did it the old-fashioned way. She wore you into submission.
I could go further with this metaphor, but that's just going to be too much for family radio. So.
All right, let's move on to the misfortune at Silver Creek Elementary School, which happens to be where my son goes.
Yeah, I was wondering if that's hit the parents pretty hard.
No, I mean... It's a small town. I know this family. They're good people. Bad, you know, good people do bad things sometimes. And this is a very bad thing that she did. And I hate it. But
it almost sounded like an act of desperation or something. I didn't know if there was, something going on.
Caught now. And I'm sure there'll be some attempt at restitution. So. Well, get that fixed, and we just got to be careful in watching those things. I mean, obviously they were watching, or they caught her. You know, it was a little late, but they did catch it. It didn't go. It wasn't years later. It wasn't. You know, yeah.
With PTOs, you're not gonna. And I wouldn't want them to have this major like check and balances. I mean, you probably want people to kind of be aware and checking. But you elect a treasurer. I mean, mm-hmm. You're not going to be looking over their shoulder.
You don't want it to become distrust. Yeah.
And it is unusual.
We're overcomplicating.
I mean, it's the first time I've ever heard of it.
Because it was caught, and it'll be fixed. And I hate it for the family. The family's the one that really has to deal with it. So.
Well, I imagine the kids probably, there's some children who go to the school.
Oh,
or,
I'm sure.
Yeah, because since she is on the PTO, so that's got to be hard, too.
And her husband's a very active person in the community. I know that for a fact. And it's just, going to be hard.
Unfortunate.
And I hate it for them.
And the fact that she did turn herself in, that's always... It says something to me, too, you know, instead of waiting for them to come out and arrest you. I mean, but what's always amazing to me is people that it's like, what were you thinking? You know, did you really think you were going to get away with
that? Well, the first time,
you know, it's like, what in the world?
Maybe it was the innocent, I'm going to pay it back, or I'll do this, or I'll hold this out of the next. And then it got to be too much, and then it got to be too easy. And, you know,
and then she had another bill or something, maybe.
And times are tough.
Yes.
They just are. That's not an excuse, but it is a motive.
Right. But I know, I mean, as I was personally thinking about it, if she had any... You know, sense of how things ran, she would have been stressed ever since they had elected a new one. Just
because,
you know, once that happened, it's like, okay.
But, you know, thinking about that was not even in the plan originally. You know, I wasn't thinking that far ahead. It was of the moment.
Right. So in some way, she might have just been waiting for the shoe to drop.
All right. Now getting on to the taxes, because this has been a hot topic everywhere I go, every time I pass the water cooler, anything. This is what people...
You've been hearing about it this week?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
That was a tough meeting, Chad. And I personally, I felt it was really unfortunate. And I, you know, this might not have been the motive. It was very good strategy to package it as all-day kindergarten. But the casualty of that, I actually ended up writing a column about that. The casualty of that is this tension now between the teachers and the community members. Because the community members weren't saying they didn't want all-day kindergarten. What they were saying is this should have happened years ago, you know, and we don't trust you. You say you're going to do this. So what really lies at the bottom of all of this? Now, Chad, did you not turn your toys off?
I don't even know where my phone is. Oh, it's over here behind me.
You techo geeks are all the same. Just carelessly lying your phones. Anyway.
I can tell on myself that was somebody challenging me to a game of Family Feud.
Woohoo!
Gonna take him up on it.
Real important stuff.
Yeah,
I could just see you and Lathan Mason up on Family Feud.
Well, one of the things I'm wondering about, you know, the trust issue in the all day kindergarten, and just a couple years ago, didn't they spend millions of dollars on the sporting facilities?
4.7.
And then, okay, so you know, we need a new stadium here, we need a new stadium there, and the all day kindergarten gets shoved in the back. The other question I have is, when you raise taxes like this, you know, for the all-day kindergarten, doesn't it just go in the pot? And well, if there's exactly. a hole in the bucket, then
well,
it just...
then let's go even further. All day kindergarten isn't going to start this fall. It's going to start next fall. Now, of course, there's going to be a need for probably some cash to get things started, like next summer or however they're going to do it. But ultimately, things aren't like that. You know, you can't say this money for that, this money for that. But then packaging it that way, what it did was it gave them this whole line of defense of teachers who are going to take on the community members for them. So, like I said, not a bad strategy, but the one that's caused a lot of wounds. And that's very unfortunate to me because there's nobody in that yeah. room who doesn't want all day kindergarten or doesn't want the best thing
for
the
exactly
kids.
Exactly right. It was not about what they were asking the money for. It was about why do you need the money to start with? Why wasn't this already taken care of? If you hadn't have 15 superintendents up there or assistant superintendent, I know I'm exaggerating, but that's the census I'm getting when I hear people talking about it.
Well, let's go even deeper under the issue of the money. To me, it really starts with transparency and communication. This is not a board that's been very open, and Tommy Floyd was not a superintendent. He never returned a phone call or message to me. It was always through public relations. This was not a group that was responsive to community requests. And I'm sorry, but you are taxpayer based. So whether you like it or not, you better start responding to your community. And that's where the trouble started. Because if everything had brought the community along, and it takes longer, and it takes time, and it takes patience, but you got to do it. I mean, Mike Hogg, every board meeting, he's like, this is where our finances stand. This is what we're facing. This is what we're cutting. This is what I'm afraid of. I mean, every board meeting, those kind of financial things are put right out there, and that saves them a lot of trouble down the line because everyone knows exactly what's going on.
But Berea Community doesn't have a new athletic facility or a roof, Beth. Where are your priorities?
Oh, they're getting a roof now. That's a good thing. Because what was really funny is that when
knows my children's names.
when Mike came to City Hall to the council chambers to report, he said, yeah, we're putting a new roof on. Yeah, I know you're thinking again.
I know, this poor building, you know.
I've been waiting since I was a toddler for that building to fly off into space anyways. I don't know.
Every single person says that. The spaceship place?
I'm
going to
die
building?
Disappointed that place never took off. You
know? Actually, I just want lightning to strike the spire and have us have no money to fix it so we can just chop the thing off.
Hey, I see a new cartoon for you or something. We'll have to work on that.
Yeah.
Something for the kids page, you know, a little flying saucer that's the Berea Community School.
Obviously, it passed by the board.
It did.
And how do you think this will affect? Is this an election year for the board? I don't even know.
Aren't they staggered?
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, I'm not sure who's coming up. I would say, I mean, what's happening right now is you've got John Lackey and Mary Renfro on the more conservative fiscal side. You've got Betty Coyle and Mona Isaacs, and Mona Isaacs is the Berea rep, who are on the side of kind of the old board that a lot of people are mad at. And then Beth... Brock, I think, was the newly elected one. And she's kind of the linchpin. You know, she's been a little more conservative. So we'll see how that works out. But I will say that Elmer Thomas, I think, conducted himself well and was much more willing to converse with community members than Tommy Floyd ever was. I mean, Floyd, I would see do the sitting bull a lot when I would go to the people would just be tackling him. He'd just be sitting there. And I'd look at him and I'd think, he is not gonna, you know, budge. You could just tell that for him, there was just, no, you know, these people were not gonna tell him how, you know, what to do.
How to pad his resume.
Exactly. So Thomas brings a different energy, and I think people are feeling cautiously optimistic. I think the big, the hard feelings are for really Becky Coyle and Mona Isaacs. And the problem is, though, that you can't run for the board if you've got a child or a parent or anybody who works in the Madison County school system. Well, that is a huge employer in this county. That leaves a lot of people out of the running who would otherwise be interested in serving the board. So it's a tough one. I guess you can do it if your kid's in the school, but you know, and that's staff, too. That's not just teachers. So that conflict of interest keeps a lot of people off.
It's interesting.
That it is. And it is one big school system, so it's complicated.
Is it the largest employer in the county?
I can't say that for sure. It's certainly one of them.
It probably is, and Eastern's probably second. It would be my guess.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be interesting to look at those numbers. Mm-hmm. I should do that.
All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to All About Berea. I've been talking about four things you should know with Beth Myers and Jonathan Schenhofen. We'll be right back after these messages. Hello and welcome back. You're listening to All About Berea once again in the studio with Beth Myers and Jonathan Schenhofen. And Jonathan, you've been out for a couple of weeks, but you've had time to think about it. And so we're going to give you the rant this week.
I think he's had the most. Yeah. He's had the most rants.
Yeah, well, it's what I do best. Okay, so this is being recorded on September 11th, 2013. You know, obviously, it's the 12-year anniversary of the attack on the World Trade Center.
Can I just say I'm embarrassed to realize I had not thought about that until now.
Well,
that this was the anniversary of 9/11.
Release a paper on Wednesday. I can understand.
Yeah, but still, I'm Wednesday. Just like, wow.
Actually, I have a news feed on my homepage, and there was not one thing about it. Where I heard the most about it was on Facebook, which is what inspired this rant.
Well, I'm a talk radio person, so I was hit first thing in the morning.
Okay. Well, okay, this is what I can't stand. The 9/11 conspiracy theorists. All right.
Ooh, yeah. Let's go.
Okay. You know, President Clinton couldn't have hanky-panky in the Oval Office without sparking a congressional hearing. We all remember that. We can't have a handful of SEALs, you know, go overseas and shoot Osama bin Laden without one of them coming out with classified information. And people who continue with this conspiracy theory insist that this massive undertaking of blowing up three or four buildings and all the mayhem could have been taken out, been carried out in secret to begin with and kept secret since. And, you know, one of the things that if you watch, they're all over the place. If you watch the videos on YouTube and there have been full length movies, is they always harp on unusual events of that day, or why didn't the Air Force scramble these planes, or why was this surveillance agency not on alert with that thing, and it goes on and on. I mean, there's hundreds of little things which are called unusual that day, but the problem with that kind of reasoning is that every second of that day was placed under such scrutiny that we have so many little tidbits and facts. We don't know if 9/11 2001 was any different from any other day because we haven't put any other day under that kind of scrutiny. And so it's easy to find coincidences and, things that didn't happen the way they were supposed to. And, anything that happened on that day was automatically unusual because it happened on that day. But this is the kicker. This is it. If you watch the videos, if you watch the full length movies, there's always somebody that gets on and says, well, the building shouldn't have collapsed this way, or the building shouldn't have collapsed under such a minor impact, or the airplane shouldn't have done this or should have done this when it collided with the building. Everyone's a structural engineer, an aviation expert, an explosives expert when it comes to looking at these videos. It's clear from the video, see? And this is my question. How many times have you flown a jetliner with a full gas tank into a skyscraper in downtown Manhattan? How do you know?
For a comparative analysis, you mean?
Yeah. How do you know what's supposed to happen? How often has that happened? These are forces and stresses and events that we didn't plan for, that we can only model mathematically, and we all know how that goes. I majored in math. And you know, so everyone's an expert all of a sudden of any kind of engineering. And oh, the video evidence is clear that, you know, they brought down these buildings on purpose. But go ahead.
So they're saying who brought the buildings down?
Oh, it's
like there's a bomb in the basement or something.
It's the government.
Either the government or Israel did it.
Like they bombed the bottom or something.
Yeah. Or even there's some people that say, oh, if you look at these points when World Trade Center 1 starts coming down, you can see it's exactly what would have happened if they had set explosive charges at all.
Imploded it.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know. Oh, it imploded, not exploded. World Trade 7 shouldn't have fallen. I mean, all this, you know. And, but this really is...
Well, this morning they had I'm not going to side rail you. This is just to add to it. They had a fire department representative talking about Building 7 and that debris had fallen off of Tower 1 and hit 7. That's why there's marks on it, and that the heat was so intense that it pretty much fried the plumbing and electrical, so they had to bring the building on down. It wasn't feasible to fix it. So it was a victim of the disaster, but not because it blew up or some plane flew into it or something, but because the heat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like I said, you know, everyone's a structural engineer. You know, this shouldn't have happened. But the other thing is this. Nobody, from what I've read, heard, scene has provided a motive, a feasible motive. You know, oh, Israel did it to get the United States to declare war on Iraq. It really wasn't.
Israel doesn't have to go through that to get us to declare.
I know, it's not that hard somebody. To get the United States to do, you know, to start a war somewhere. And there have been no leaks since. Go back to the president with his infatuated intern in the Oval Office. You know, what did that take? 8 months to come out? Well, nobody has come forth with any evidence that this was some sort of pre-planned thing. So every time I see this, it really bothers me, and this is why. At the root of it, we don't have to continue to tell our personal stories about how traumatic 9/11 was, what we lost, what friends of ours lost. That is all very well documented. Bottom line, when you continue with these sorts of insane fantasies, you're doing a disservice to those who lost, and it's dishonor for everyone who sacrificed in the at the time and in the aftermath. It's just a horrible thing to do to all of those people, and that's really what bothers me about it.
Well, thank you very much for bringing that up, and I only have one question. Who do you think the second shooter was?
But
you're talking about old.
I was.
Oh, anyway, once again, our hearts out to the 9/11 victim families who were in full effect in New York this morning. That was a well-attended ceremony, and I noticed that several places around were having little ceremonies. One place, the Reds were playing today. They played Chicago, and I hope they won. I didn't get to see the final or hear the final on the radio, but I'm hoping they won because they lost last night horribly. But anyway, the Reds were playing, and before it started, they had first responders as throwing, you know, the ball, and they had a first responder that was singing the national anthem. It was really touching. So anyway, all that being said, thank you very much. We're going to take another quick break while we get Greg Powell in here for our interview. And you're listening to All About Berea with Jonathan Schenhofen sharing with us, and Beth Myers in the studio as well. We'll be back after these messages. Hello and welcome back to All About Berea. I'm Chad Hembry in the studio with Beth Myers, Jonathan Schenhofen, and joining us, we have a very special guest, and I'll let you introduce him.
Yes, a very well-dressed man here who has come in, Greg Powell, who is the co-chair of the, is it strictly the Spoonbread Festival, or is this the wider festival committee? Spoonbread Festival, with under the Chamber of Commerce auspices. So I asked him to come in and talk to us a little bit about what's going to be happening in Berea in another week. As we do our
our next
huge
show
big Berea House
during
party.
The festival.
Exactly.
Yes.
So I thought let's get a heads up on this. So thanks for coming, Greg. I appreciate
You're welcome. Thanks for having me. This is the 17th annual Spoonbread Festival for Berea. It's a chamber signature event.
When did the chamber take it over, Greg?
The chamber has always done it.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that.
It's always been a chamber.
I think some
event.
People have the impression that somehow the chamber took it on after a couple of years, but you know how that goes, the anecdotal legacy that spreads around town.
No, the chamber started it, and we
okay.
still got it.
Okay.
Sometimes we think it's going to outgrow the chamber. In the last 5 years, we've more than doubled in size. As of right now, we have 160 vendors slated to be here the weekend of September 19, 20, and 21. And
is that an increase from last year? The vendors have grown in the last couple of years, right?
Yes, the vendors have grown considerable. The dates are the September 20, 21, and 22. I inadvertently said the 19th. But yes, it has grown. Vendors in the last 2 years, the vendors have doubled.
Wow. Well, and I know for us, just the things you have added has made it much more appealing for us as a family to usually head down there, like the inflatables and some other things that have been added in the past several years. And I'm sure as the attendance has grown, the vendors probably come along with it.
Attendance has just gone through the roof in the last 4 years. I think last year we had like 17 different states represented in vendors, and we have folks that attend huge festivals, and they tell us that ours is growing, and we would guesstimate somewhere between 15,000-20,000 people through the park over the weekend during Spoonbread.
Have you ever watched the time-lapse video I do every year of it?
I have to say I haven't.
It's on Berea Online, and every year I do this little time lapse, and they're still on there. You can go back and find them. Just type in 2012 or 2011, you'll get them. That fixed camera point, and to see the people move in from sun up till sundown, and then the concerts at night, just see how many people pass that, and I think it runs the 24 hours in. It runs 24 hours in 2 minutes. So it's pretty amazing to watch it.
Yeah.
That sounds like one we saw at in New York at the train station. We saw one of those time-lapse videos.
Yeah.
I
love
how many people come through.
It's so neat because it shows you a progression that it really shows what times of the day it's real busy too, because it shows you the running clock down there,
That probably brings in more than any other Berea event,
I would say.
If we're talking 15,000 to 20,000, that far exceeds craft festivals,
We exceed all the other festivals combined, most likely.
What do you attribute that success to, Greg?
I think we're a festival-friendly town. I really do. We work hard in the chamber to get the vendors in, get them out. We help them. We have somebody there all weekend, and Berea is a great place to come to. I mean, when we do some unscientific polling with the restaurants and the hotels, and they're full. Some of the restaurants will tell you it's their best weekend of the year, Spoonbread. So not only it's not just concentrated there in the city park at the Memorial Park, but it's citywide, really and truly. And Berea is just a great place to come visit. And this happens to be, typically we have good weather, and
when we have kind of that whole park system, because now it's like you've got the expansion park and you guys are out there in the Memorial Park, and then you kind of go through the expansion park through the school and you get to the hot air balloons. It's like this whole park system that kind of follow the whole festival.
By the way, our hot air balloons, we hopeful to have We're possibly going to have 8 balloons this year, which is the most we've ever had.
Remax being one of them, right? Yeah. Did I get in? Yeah.
6 to 8 balloons. You know, we couldn't do this without our sponsors. They're, and you can go to the Chamber website and actually the Spoonbread website, and it's just spoonbreadfestival.com, and you can see all of our sponsors and the community.
Yeah, you get about everybody in town, don't you, signing on?
Everybody in town signs on. It's hundreds of hours that weekend, thousands of hours that weekend if you count everybody that's there, that's working, that's doing something, and it's family friendly. It's fun. You know, it's all free. Nobody charges anything to get in. Now the carnival, those folks, there is a charge to do their rides, but Kiddyland mm-hmm. is free. The balloon rides on Saturday
concerts,
morning,
yeah.
concerts. You know, we've got an impressive list of concerts all weekend long. You know, we open at 3:00 on Friday, and our first concert, is New Generation Bluegrass Band from 6 to 7. All booths open at 3:00 and stay open until 9:00 on Friday, and then they open again at 10:00 on Saturday, and they're open until 9:00, and then noon until 5 on Sunday.
Well, you're talking about all these improvements you're making. I have to ask you one thing. What can you do to improve the taste of spoon bread?
Now, Jonathan Schinhofen.
You put jelly on it, my friend.
When I was there last year, I remember Mike Hogg and a couple of others in that little tractor thing going, tearing back and forth to the folk center kitchen with pans and pans and pans and pans of spoon bread. I think they sold, I don't even know how much they sold. They told me once, I asked them because I was going to do that in the article.
We sold,
and it was like this amazing amount of spoon bread that they sold. It was crazy.
It is. I have to plug my wife a little bit here, Gail Powell. She kind of oversees the kitchen, her and Nola Newman and Linda Van Winkle. They really get in the kitchen and get volunteers, and all the spoon bread is made there in the Folk Center kitchen.
Oh, I remember them just tearing up back with coolers with
nice
these pans.
New
yeah,
year.
Yeah, it'll be
and
made
they had
in
all
nice
the condiments,
kitchen.
Honey and butter and jelly.
Some people like
everything. Yeah.
Butter on it. Some people like honey. Some people like both honey and butter.
And I seem to remember I had several that weekend, so you know
it is good. Well, you have to have a, you have to acquire a taste for
yeah.
it.
It's been
he's
many,
a Yankee.
It's been many years, and the last time I had it, I have to admit it was from the Boone Tavern. So maybe
you really should
ours.
Get the fresh. You should yeah. get the fresh.
Yeah. All right, I'll give it a shot this year.
We have a lot of people. I'm not taking away from Boone Tavern because Boone Tavern and Mr. Hagen's recipe is the reason for. You know, that's the thought behind our festival. But we have a lot of people that say our spoon bread's better.
So, see?
All right, I'll give it a shot.
And we just ordered 150 gallons of milk, 150 dozen eggs. Probably a whole skid of cornmeal. It'll be an assembly line. If you want to volunteer to come help in the kitchen, you don't have to.
And
do
this will
everything.
Be cooked on a new stove, right?
Yeah. The city has graciously stepped up, and they're in the process of remodeling the Folk Center kitchen. And
I know that kept coming in the meeting. We got to get the stuff by spoon bread. Got to get the stuff by spoon bread.
and I'm sure they will. We're looking forward to it. My wife especially is looking forward to it. She, you know, what we had there was adequate, somewhat, but what we're getting will be more than adequate, will be a welcome change.
I'm excited about it. I love this festival. You know, I'm there till the day.
From the time we open till
the time
it goes away.
When the last people to leave. I love it. And just seeing everyone and participating is fantastic. One thing I do like about our festival is, like you said, it's a very good, it's well organized. The chamber does so well in putting it on, and there's so many hard workers and so many unsung heroes every year. I just try to think off the top of my head of people that maybe you wouldn't even know, but think about Joe, the electrician that works.
Oh, yeah.
Comes down for the city.
Yeah, and he's on call all weekend.
Could anyone be any more helpful than him? I mean,
we
fantastic.
Call him, and he's there. He's like a a little magic man. He just appears.
Right, just handles a crisis and then leaves.
Yeah. And Gator, that runs the sound, not only does he come there and run sound for us for a reasonable rate and give us a huge discount, but he sleeps on the stage to provide security. And he watches the whole thing. The police check with him, you know, has anybody been walking around, you know. It's great.
It is great. And we have our entertainers say that our sound, that Gator is incredible. They wish that they would, in their professional venues, they could get sound technicians that do what he does and go out of the way to make their music sound as good as he does. And
well, you know, we came here maybe 16 years ago, Beth and I. And Berea is a great place to be. Berea is a great place to have a festival. But the Spoonbread, I think it sort of brings in one weekend all the things that are really cool about Berea.
Yeah, you can get gilded artists, crafts there. You can get
less gilded.
You can get cornhole boards. You can get it all has to be handmade. There's a wide array of food, different in our food court.
Free massages.
Yep, free massages.
That's right.
Where did I get one of those?
Oh, there was two booths last year.
Yeah.
Well, and they usually set up a mothers with young children, or was it a nursing mother's station?
Yep.
I know they did. They do that every year.
Yeah.
You get to walk through the inflatable colon.
Do it every chance I get.
And that will be back this year.
Okay.
I was told that today.
I have to put a plug in for the 5K, of course.
Oh yes.
Oh yeah. There's and actually, you know, the festivities actually start this Saturday, the 14th. We'll have our excuse me, our beauty pageant will be...
That's out at the Berea Community School, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
And at the Gary Konkin Gymnasium, the new gym there at the community school. Now, and that's the only thing, that if you're interested in getting your child in that pageant, you need to go ahead and get that registration in. But otherwise, all of our other events, you can just walk right up. If you've got an old car and you want to enter it in a car show on Sunday, come out at 9 o'clock. You don't have to pre-register. You come out at 9 o'clock, register your car.
It. It's laid back. I love it.
Yeah,
boy,
same
Rick
thing.
Does a great job.
Yes,
that.
He does. Yeah. He does a phenomenal job with that. And you know, last year I think we had like 130 cars. We're expecting more this year. On Saturday, Friday night, and Saturday, there'll be an old tractor show. You got a tractor you want to put in it? Antique tractor show. Bring your tractor out and have at it. Be a motorcycle show on Saturday, our parade. So there's something for every age group. We have rock and roll under the tent. We have country under the tent. We have bluegrass under the tent. We have an African drum ensemble under the tent. So
that's
whatever
fantastic
genre you want.
As
music,
eclectic as this town.
Yeah.
I tell you, by the way, that was Rick Cox. I was trying to look his name real quick.
The electrician.
The one that does the car show. He works so hard on that. Also, they get those old hearses in. Will they be back this year?
Yes. The Professional Car Society will be back this year.
That's so cool. It is.
Yes.
It is so cool.
And I don't know exactly how many are coming, but quite a few.
I hope we don't need them.
You know, it just occurred to me when you're thinking
great
of how the craft festivals have always been flooded out half the time. It just doesn't seem like the Spoonbread usually is. Now that
it's
I think back,
it's been rained on before.
Doesn't that tend to be the exception? Like when I think
it tends
of
to be the exception, yes.
Which is actually amazing when you think of the history of festivals.
On wood or something.
Yeah, somebody's going to knock me
like
on
that.
The head if it starts to rain.
Okay.
But I just realized that there's not been many times it hasn't.
Not many at all.
One more thing I want to shine a spotlight on is that how clean it is,
and I will attribute that to our city workers. Berea,
the streets department.
The streets department.
And, yeah.
Those fellas never complain. We ask for anything. They jump right on one of their gators and go do it. And they're walking the park the entire time, from the time it opens until the time it closes, changing out trash cans, picking up trash. You can walk through our festival at any aspect of it, and you just won't see trash on the ground.
The bathrooms are clean.
Yeah.
There's water. There's paper towels. There's nothing on the ground. If there is something on the ground, I can guarantee you in an hour it's gone. You know, somebody will have picked it up.
Yeah.
It is. It amazes me. And you can watch that.
Well, and that sets a culture,
too. On the time lapse, you can see a big grass area, and every once in a while something hits the ground, it's gone. I mean, it's just that quick.
Yeah. The streets department, those fellas... They're incredible, you know. And the city's really good to the chamber in this festival in offering help. And you know, we get the city police there at night to act as security, and they patrol. And the city street department, like Chad was saying, that they're phenomenal. We couldn't do it. They start on Monday before the festival. They drive the poles for our banners. They help us hang the banners. They help us take them down. They're there from beginning to end. The chamber operates this festival. We put it on, and David Rowlett with the chamber does the majority of the legwork all throughout the year. But when it gets to crunch time, there are hundreds of people within our community that take ownership of a portion of the festival and run with it, and we couldn't do it without them.
And the schools participate, and the hospital. I mean, there's just so many organizations out there that get involved.
The hospital's taking ownership of our 5K, and they estimate that the way it is growing. Mm-hmm. It will be one of the largest 5Ks in the state.
See, that's just it, anything this.
Well, this town is becoming known for its 5Ks. Yeah, it's really amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for coming in, and you've really gotten me pepped up.
Thank you all. Thank you all for having us, and thank you for Berea Online. It's a great service.
Of course, you can go to the Chamber's website, BereaChamber.com, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Chamber. Yeah, BereaChamber.com. But there's also a website for the Spoonbread Festival, correct?
Correct. It's SpoonbreadFestival.com, or you can join us on Facebook at Facebook.com/SpoonbreadFestival. So
Spoonbread Festival, spelled out.
And the Spoonbread insert will be coming out on the 19th in the paper.
Fantastic. Well, thanks again for coming in. We're going to go straight into our calendar events. If you'll just sit still for a second, we're going to run through the zoo and wrap this show up.
All right. So I guess that's my cue, Chad.
Yes, ma'am.
This weekend, there's actually going to be different art workshops from September 13th and 15th, most of them in Old Town Berea. This is kind of an extension of the Learn Shops with a few people doing it. With such things as blow your own ornament special, stained glass sun catcher with overlay, make a 6-inch agate window, or make a glass angelfish, a brass or copper necklace. You can go to the Berea.com website to get the listings, but these types of workshops they're having this weekend, you actually sign up with the artist, not with tourism. So that'll be happening all through the 13th to the 15th. On Saturday, as mentioned before, there's going to be the library's 25th birthday party at 10 a.m.
Where I said what I'm going to do.
That's right. It starts at 10 a.m. Pony rides, cupcakes for Chad, balloon animals. So come out and help them celebrate their silver anniversary. Next Wednesday, there's going to be the tablet computer showcase from 2 to 4 p.m. at the library. I'm sure Chad will have an opinion on that. Android, iPad, and Windows 8 available. Technology and structure to be present to help people look through the options. This weekend, there's also going to be a sale at the Berea Senior Citizens Center, September 13th and 14th. This is women's clothing. Friday evening, 6 to 8 p.m., Saturday from 9 to 4. This is the Better Brands of suits, dresses, sweaters, sizes 12 to 16. This coming Monday, the Jefferson Street Homemakers is going to start their new year with a meeting at the Berea Senior Citizen Center at 1 p.m. The lesson is on making soups. The craft is on corn shuck flowers. All interested in joining this group are welcome to attend. You don't have to be from Jefferson Street. And from September 18th to 20th, there's going to be the Fall Revival at Ferristown Baptist Church. Reverend Robert Bly is going to be the guest minister on those 3 days. The service begins at 7 p.m. each evening. All invited to attend. Next Thursday, there's going to be a movie at the library for all the new Trekkies, Star Trek Into Darkness at 4 p.m. next Thursday. And then, as we've just been talking about it, the next weekend, the 20th, 21st, and 22nd is the 17th Annual Spoonbread Festival at Memorial Park. So be sure to join in the festivities. And that's it for the calendar of events.
Thank you very much, Beth. And if you want to come to the library, you'll probably see me there.
Come see Chad and right. celebrate the silver anniversary.
Riding a pony, holding a cupcake in one hand, reading in another. No. I'm not sure I can balance that way.
I was about to say, you'll probably have his computer reading an online book.
Yeah. Last time I got on a pony, my feet were drug the ground. It just takes the whole effect away. Thanks for listening. You've been listening to All About Berea. I want to thank Beth Myers, Jonathan Schenhofen, and Greg Powell for being in the studio with us. Have a wonderful week. We hope that we see you out and about. Join us next week for more Berea news.
All About Berea is brought to you by Good Impressions Design, for screen printing, trophies, plaques, signs and more. Check out Good Impressions' full line of services and make a good impression with your business today on the web at goodimpressionsdesign.com. By the Berea Citizen, serving the community since 1899, this Berea icon continues to produce award-winning news stories and features. Pick up your copy today or sign up for a weekly subscription by calling 859-986-0959. By BereaOnline.com. Constantly updated, this site is the most up-to-date place to find what's going on in Berea. Loaded with videos, shows, stories, articles and a full calendar of events, this site has been the place to go on the web for Bereans since 1995. The name says it all, it's Berea Online. The opinions expressed on All About Berea are not those of BereaOnline.com, the Berea Citizen, nor any other sponsor. All About Berea is a production of Tech Talk Studios and recorded weekly in Berea, Kentucky, in partnership with the Creative Tech Media Group and BereaOnline.com. All About Berea is co-produced by Rhonda McIntyre, co-produced and directed by Chad Himbry, and finally, our senior news editor is Beth Myers. If you would like to participate in All About Berea, or simply have a suggestion, we would love to hear from you. Just go to BereaOnline.com and click on All About Berea at the top of the page. For sponsorship opportunities, contact the Creative Tech Media Group at creativetechmedia.com or phone 859-626-6054. From all of us here at Tech Talk Studios, and on behalf of the cast and crew of All About Berea, thanks for listening.